On August of 1979, an accident occurred in the North Sea, which proved to be fatal for two American saturation divers, subsequently exposing the corruption that occurred in this multi-million oil industries and overall changing the safeties in the diving community. This is the story of Oil Rig Diving Incident. Before I tell you about the incident, you need to know certain elements of deep sea or saturation or scuba diving. Now, these activities involves a human being going to the depths of the ocean, which is naturally impossible. I am talking about 1,000 to 2,000 feet deep, which puts him or her in a greater risk on their life. Now, the dangers I'm talking here is not about the sharks or any other sea predators. I mean, they can also be considered one of many dangerous situations you experience down there. But as you access the deeper parts of the ocean, less and less the sunlight enters, and the system which you are going through will be completely black, completely darkened out, and it gets cold down there. So then your only friend would be this high-powered flashlight, which only illuminates the path you are shining onto. And it only goes to the range of 10 meters. You won't even know what is lurking around you with that amount of darkness. The other problems are decompression sickness and nitrogen necrosis. Now, what a decompression sickness is, when you keep descending into the ocean, you are exposed to high pressures of water bodies, and you slowly start to consume nitrogen. You start to breathe this nitrogen gas. Now, having nitrogen in your body is not harmful as long as you stay in this high pressure system. But as soon as you start swimming to the surface, this nitrogen gas starts bubbling up in your bloodstreams, and it won't leave your body for a very long period of time. Symptoms include vomiting, nausea, and joint pains. You know, if not treated, this may lead to a fatal life-threatening situation here. Now, the solution is simple. When underwater, you need to make decompression stops. What it means is you need to make as many stops as possible at given checkpoints when ascending to the surface of the ocean. During these stops, the nitrogen naturally leaves your body. So the solution is very simple, right? But the act of carrying out is really stressful and time consuming. According to a study, if you dive up to 160 feet deep into the water, it will only take 60 minutes to descend down to that depth. But going up, it takes almost 4 hours to reach back safely. Now think about 1,000 feet deep diving. It would take 3 days to come back to the surface, which is experimentally impossible, and it's very expensive. The other problem is nitrogen narcosis, which means you will have a lack of sense to your surroundings. You feel numb and don't give a shit what is going around you. It's basically like being in a drunken state. And at this point, when you're underwater 1,000 feet deep, if you lose consciousness, that is the end of you. No one will ever find you, and no one will ever know that where did you go missing. So to be on the safer side, it is not at all good to go to these underwater depths. You know, stay on the land and enjoy the fresh air. But there are some risk takers who wants to explore these parts of the ocean to study or basically have an adventure. At least they have a choice, but not saturation divers. So basically, saturation divers are like construction workers who go to this deepest part of the sea and tend to repair or salvage broken pipes, vents, you know, mainly working in underwater oil rigs. Before, as I said, that you need to make these stops to avoid decompression sickness, and it takes way longer hours and the work gets delayed very often. So these diving companies came up with a plan, creating an underwater saturated environment. So the saturated environment consists of this deck decompression chamber, diver transfer chamber, and a submersible decompression chamber, commonly known as the diving bell. First, the divers are kept in this deck decompression chamber, which is present on the ship or the vessels. They stay in that chamber for weeks together to match the pressure underwater. Then they are slowly moved to this diving bell where the whole chamber is lowered to the required depth for the work or the, where the construction need to be done. Now the diving bell is not just an empty chamber. Oxygen and required hot water circulation is provided to prevent hypothermia. Even the power is supplied to this diving bell at those depths. All this is done through a set of wires or cords known as umbilical. So if these wires get disconnected, divers are doomed of fresh air, coldness, and will live in total darkness until they are rescued. Now let's talk about the incident. An oil field near Scotland known as Thestral Oil Field, present in the center of the North Sea. A single anchor leg mooring system, basically known as SALM, is attached to the oil field, used for basically loading oil tankers. Over time, the SLM got damaged and needed to be repaired. So the two professional divers, Richard Arthur Walker, who was 32, and Victor Francis Guell Jr., sorry if I pronounced the name wrong, was 28 at the time, were selected to carry out this process of diving deep up to 500 feet, doing the necessary changes, staying in the decompression chamber for weeks, and moving on with life. Of course, this could have happened if some minor mistakes would have been avoided. And if you look back, it is really frustrating to think that how authorities manhandled the operation for getting the work done quickly rather than thinking of safety. When the diving bell was lowered through the MS Wildrake, that's the diving support vessel or the ship which was present on the surface level. So Richard and Victor, these gentlemen were in the decompression chamber for a week already. So when they were in this cold water of depth around 485 feet, they suited up, put on their wetsuit to get out of the chamber. So how this works is one of them stays in the bell while the other goes out to fix it. When that other person returns, the one present in the bell, it is his time to start up his shift or work. So when Walker was outside in the early mornings of the 8th August 1979, he noticed that the lift had become disengaged from the bell. The lift is an attachment between the vessel and the bell which holds the bell and prevents it from sinking to the ocean floor. Even though the lift was detached, the bell stayed in the place because the umbilical was still intact and was kind of acting like an alternative lift, but still it's not as strong as the lift though. So after sending distress signal back to the vessel, Richard joined Victor in the bell and sealed it shut, hoping for the best. Back on the surface, the crew knew they were in trouble, and the only thing that is keeping the bell from sinking is the umbilical cord. At this point, the crew made a very bad decision of lifting the bell with the help of umbilical. One thing is, umbilical is a series of pipes used to supply oxygen, power, and other necessary things, and definitely not for using it like a rope. But they did not think of any alternatives, and when they began to pull, the umbilical gave away and the bell dragged the divers to the bottom of the ocean with no air or power. Another diving vessel, Stena Wilder, was nearby. Its divers were ready to help the drowned divers. So they put on the gear and were lowered using their own bell. After a certain depth, they opened the hatch and began searching for the lost bell. But they couldn't locate it due to the fact that Wildrake had moved from its original location, and also the communication had cut between them. So it nearly took an hour to locate the bell. After finding the bell, the crew noticed that the bell's position was not upright. It was tilted at a certain angle, meaning the hatch through which the divers could have gotten out was completely blocked. So when the divers looked through the porthole, the glass window basically, they saw Richard and Victor giving thumbs up and were relieved, like they were sure that they would be rescued now. But that was not easy. With the hatch door blocked, they needed to physically lift the bell using the crane from the vessel. So it took another hour to bring the guide wire down and was attached to the bell. Now, as there was no communication between the rescuers, they had to go on a hunch, and when the crane began to lift, the bell began to collide with the walls of SALM. At one point, the wire snapped and the bell sank again to the floor. The rescuers once again attempted to locate the bell and reconnect the wires, which again took more than an hour. But the guidelines snapped again. During this period, the divers kept on checking Richard and Victor, who now were distressed and very, very frantic. At one point, they even accepted their fate. So, After several hours, the bell was finally lifted and put back on the vessel. But it was too late by then. Richard Walker and Victor Francis had died of hypothermia, which basically means they died of freezing temperature. Even before this event had occurred, Walker was very stressed with the work he was doing and decided to do this one last job and go back to his wife and 14-month-old daughter. Brian Masterson, co-founder of Infabco Diving Service, in which Richard and Victor worked, found out that he actually bribed for contracts and there were no safety procedures carried out to make sure the diving bell was secure. The entire diving bell system was rigged and faulty from the beginning, and the company were fined by the court and made them pay a compensation amount to both the deceased family and also upgrade their diving bell system. But no matter what you do now, you can't bring back Richard and Victor to life. There was a book written by another diver, Michael Smart, who knew what was really going on. He exposed the corruption, particularly people who were to blame for the diver's death, and how the deceased family were treated after the case was filed. The book name is Into the Lion's Mouth, which gives even more in-depth analysis of the incident. You can check the book out for more information. I haven't read it, but other people say that it is really good and kind of become a guidebook to other divers on how to avoid accidents and take safety protocols.